All right, testing, testing, very good. Well, thank you for coming this afternoon. Just trying to sound up here. Thank you for coming. My name is Andrew Beckwith. I am president of Massachusetts Family Institute. We are here today to talk about the threat to privacy and safety in House Bill 4253 and Senate Bill 735, the so-called gender identity and non-discrimination bills. It is important that we as the public understand the facts about these bills. We have been told that this legislation is necessary to prevent discrimination in places of public accommodation, like restaurants, movie theaters, hospitals. Let me be very clear, those claims are simply false. Right now, under existing Massachusetts law, if someone believes they have been discriminated against because of their gender identity in a restaurant, they can file a claim with the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination, the state administrative agency authorized to handle all discrimination claims. If this gender identity legislation were to pass, the process for addressing discrimination claims in public accommodations would remain exactly as it is now. In fact, MCAD has publicly reported the successful adjudication of just such a claim. The same can be said about hospitals. MCAD has successfully adjudicated the claim of gender identity discrimination in a hospital in a situation where a woman who identified as a man wanted to be artificially inseminated. Now, the hospital felt it didn't have the professional expertise to handle such a unique scenario and politely demurred. This was prosecuted as discrimination on the basis of gender identity by the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination. If the Beckwith bill is passed, the legal recourse for someone who believes they have been discriminated against on the basis of gender identity in a hospital will remain exactly the same. However, right now, if a man wishes to express himself as female and enters a woman's locker room, bathroom, or fitness center, or homeless shelter, he can be asked to leave and to use the men's facility by the real woman whose privacy and safety are threatened by his presence. If this bathroom bill is passed, those real women and children will have no power to object to that man's presence, or even to his disrobing in the same room with them, when they themselves may be in various stages of undress. In short, if this legislation is passed, women and children will have no protection against being ogled by or exposed to naked men. This is why we refer to this legislation as the bathroom bill, because that is the principal effect of this law passing, eliminating common sense privacy protection, especially for women and children. This needs to be made clear. Many legislators may not understand exactly how this bill works and be taken in by claims of discrimination in public places other than bathrooms and locker rooms. Now again, the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination has been crystal clear. They already cover such claims. Under existing Massachusetts law and administrative policy, gender identity already trumps any and all objections, with the one very important exception of intimate places where people are exposed and particularly vulnerable, where the desire to express one's current gender identity runs up against the right to privacy of everyone else. And this is why we've called this press conference, so that the public and their representatives in the Massachusetts legislature can hear directly from someone like Katie Drew, a young woman and mother who makes a powerful and personal case against dismissing or evading the privacy rights of women and children in public restrooms and changing facilities. Now, when I objected to this legislation at the public hearing last fall on behalf of my wife, and six-year-old daughter, I was dismissed as if I were a racist. The Attorney General of Massachusetts recently dismissed me and all the citizens with objections to this bill by telling us we can just hold it if we feel uncomfortable or threatened in a bathroom. So I would ask the Attorney General, and I would ask the legislators, to listen very carefully to what Ms. Triller has to say, and know that she speaks for millions of mothers, fathers, children, and concerned citizens, not just in Massachusetts, but as this issue has erupted nationally in the past weeks, for those of us all across the country